I'm Emily Rancier, and I've been on this farm for about 40 years and had sheep for about 25, and gotten into all the crafts that are related to sheep. I had sheep for a hobby. Sold the meat lambs at the end of the season to pay for the hay, and then I got all the wool that came off them. Some of the wool that I got from my sheep is still out there. Some has been processed, and some I've actually dyed and sold and made things with. It all started with sheep, and I've moved on to, you know, the spinning, and then I've moved into other textile crafts like silk painting. I'm doing a lot of felting now, and forgoing the spinning and just getting into the wool and making flat fabric. When we have sheep, at the end of March, usually, before they lamb, I like to shear them. And in the old days, this is what they used, was just a pair of scissors like this that would cut all the fleece off. But now they use electric shears, and you'll get locks. You'll get a whole fleece, and they'll be full of locks. Now these locks are washed, and you can see the crimp, which is the curl, which helps you in your spinning. Each fiber that's there has little scales like a pine cone, so that also helps you when you come to spin. Those little scales will grab. This is what it looks like when it comes right off the sheep, and if you even touch it, you can feel the lanolin. And when you process it either by machine or with carders, you're going to get a product like this. And this is really ready to spin. This is the carder. To get to this point, it's either gone to a machine, which this has, or you have used carders and opened up the locks. Here's an example, just taking a lock, and you just sort of put it on the card like this, and then you essentially are combing it out and getting all the little second cuts until it's nice and open like that. Then you just roll it off your carder and it would be ready to spin. And it just sort of aligns all the fibers so that they're ready to spin. You can also get that alignment by using combs. And then you can spin. And you can spin with a wheel or you can spin with a spindle. Up until 1500s, everything in the world, from sails to clothes, was made by the hand spindle. And what you do is you just spin off your knee or whatever, and you draw the wool up and let the twist come into the wool. And when it stops spinning, then you have to stop and give it more spin. When you have a single, then you usually will ply it if you're going to knit with it. And these are two single threads plied and twisted around each other so that they're plied. And with your yarn, you can knit, you can crochet, you can weave. These are different kind of shuttles. If you were making a rag rug, you'd use a shuttle like that. But in case of a scarf, you would use a boat shuttle. You take your yarn and you wind them onto the bobbins. Now in this case, you can see there's a bobbin here and it's wound with yarn. And this is what will pass between your threads when you weave. The same with this, but you'd be using strips of fabric if you were making a rag rug. Here it could be either a strip of fabric or a yarn. Now this is all like colonial era, 1700s and into the 1800s in some areas. There are all kinds of plant dyes that are local that could be used, and there were some exotic things that you would have to buy even back then. Madder is a root that would be grown in the colonial garden and would give you reds. Walnut hulls are wonderful browns, all different shades. Black-eyed Susans, I love. They give a wonderful sage green. Because other greens, you usually have to dye a yellow and then indigo on top. A marigold gives a yellow and then with copper sulfate. So you can also determine colors by different chemicals being added to the water. This is indigo. It's a lump that has been pulverized into a powder, and it's a very cool process. It's all developed in a vat, and it's cold, and you dip your yarns or your fabric in, and you bring it out, and it oxidizes and changes blue. So you bring out sort of a greenish color, and before your eyes, it just magically turns to blue. Indigo was used a lot in colonial days, and indigo was grown in South Carolina a lot. Cochineal was another thing that they would have had to buy, and these are little tiny bugs. Bugs that you pulverize and make into a dye, which has lovely reds, garnet reds. Different barks. This is from the Osage orange tree, just a sawdust that is a dye plant. Marigold gives great dye. Goldenrod, different shades of brass and yellow. This was just plain tea. If you were rich enough to put your tea into dye wool. Onion skins, another thing that would be around the home that could be used. In the early years of America, linen was very important, and every family, if they had the land, would plant a quarter acre for each person in the family. They would have to plant a quarter acre of flax. And then they would, at the end of the season, the end of summer probably, they would pull it up by the roots, and they would dry it in their barn for up to a year. And then, at that end of the year, they would put it in a pond or a stream and ret it, which meant rotting out the outside of the stem. This is after it's been rotted and then dried again. The inner pith had to disappear, and the outer bark, so you could get the bast fiber, which is the middle layer. So they would take, this is called a break, and they would go like this all along the fiber. And you see, it's not breaking the fiber, it's just breaking that outside bark. See this, what's fallen on the ground? That's called boon. And they would use that even to fill horse collars or mattresses. The seeds would also be saved for flaxseed oil and for planting the next year. Now after that, using the break, they would take a scutching knife, and they would have a board like this set in another plank down here, so it's at an angle, and they would use this knife to scrape more of this boon off the fiber. And at that point, they would go to the hackles. It would start with hackles, these nails being very far apart, then a little bit closer, then a little bit closer, until they were really fine. And at each point, they would take this fiber, which had flip it onto here and draw it through. And these were affixed, and they would fling it like that. And everything that was left in here, they also would use. And they would use this for cordage, for rope, and they might use it for tow spinning, which would give you a fabric like this, very coarse linen. You could put boon in it, you could put corn husks for a mattress. And they would just keep doing this until all they have left were the very finest and softest fibers, and that they would spin into a nice thread for weaving with. And they might bleach it, and it would come out looking like this. It's very soft already, and could be spun into fine linen thread, which could be then woven into a fine linen towel. So this is the fiber that comes all sort of lined up and cleaned up. And then it's going to be pulled out like a fan on your lap, and then you wind it around a distance. And this is a true flax wheel. All these little wheels like this were flax wheels. They have a very small orifice here, so they couldn't have taken a thick wool thread, but they were perfect for spinning flax into linen, because they're very speedy, and you can have a very fine thread. Now I'm moistening my hands for spinning flax or linen, because there's it seals them together. There's pectin in these fibers, so this just helps seal the fibers together as you spin them together. But as I spin, this wheel takes it up on the bobbin. There was nonstop work. I mean, it was just not like cleaning, washing clothes, preparing all the food, but she has got to have a fabric production going at all times. And therefore, their children usually would learn how to do the hand spindle and eventually the wheel. And she would keep her younger children busy carding. And a lot of times, one lady in the family who didn't marry would be enlisted as the spinster for that family. And that's how that word came to be. This was considered the wool wheel, and that was the flax wheel. And this is spun off a spindle, off the point, just like this. The wheel would spin this around, and your spinning would just pop, 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 and it would spin out this way, and then you turn the wheel so it winds up. This is called a nitty knotty, and it was used for skeining your wool yarn. And you would just wind your yarn so that you had probably a yard going the whole way around. This is actually a device for pulling up the nap on a woven fabric, especially on the wools if you want a nice fluffy surface. This is a very stiff kind of teasel. They would be, you know, massive ones for industry that would run along the cloth, and it would pick up the fiber so you'd get a fluffy surface. This is actually a bat of brown wool right from the mill. It's all been aligned like this was. And I just placed it crossing different layers of that felted bat. So one would go this way, the other one would like this. So there are about four layers. And what you do is you moisten it with soap and water, and you do a lot of massaging and tamping down until it's really flat and all wet, totally wet. Felted wool is wool that has been put together in layers, crisscrossing. Warm water and soap applied, and then agitation. Yeah, this is a simple loom. I've just wound jute string around and around, and it's placed fairly evenly across. And this is just using fabric rags. A simple in and out, in and out. And then you change the shed. One time you'll go through that way, and then you'll change it and go the other way with
it. It was a good way for them to use old clothes that were no, you know, ripping. They would rip them into rag strips, and they could make, you know, rag rugs.
I think when you just buy a piece of fabric, you have no idea what goes into it. And now that I've done all this study of fiber and fabric and dyes, that I understand more what goes into the production of cloth. I really like knowing that I'm part of a tradition that goes way back for women being the producers of fiber and fabric, and that history is important to keep up. I think there's a legacy there for all of us.